whom Christ, your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see, those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. And it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Mantengamos firme la profesión de nuestra fe. En efecto, no tenemos un sumo sacerdote que no sea capaz de compadecerse de nuestro sufrimiento, puesto que él mismo ha pasado por las mismas pruebas que nosotros, excepto el pecado. Acerquémonos, por tanto, con plena confianza al trono de la gracia, para recibir misericordia, hallar la gracia y obtener ayuda en el momento oportuno. Precisamente por eso, Cristo, durante su vida mortal, ofreció oraciones y súplicas, con fuertes voces y lágrimas, a aquel que podía librarlo de la muerte, y fue escuchado por su piedad. A pesar de que era el Hijo, aprendió a obedecer padeciendo, y llegada a su perfección, se convirtió en la causa de la salvación eterna para todos los que lo obedecen. Palabra de Dios.
Te alabamos.
Across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Who are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave you?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guard seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now, the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now, the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answered the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Anna sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
Didn't I see you in the garden with him?
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If you were not a criminal, we should not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
We do not have the right to execute anyone.
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priest handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king?"
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is the truth?"
Then when he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this one, but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And Pilate said to them,
"Behold, the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God."
Now, when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium, and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you, and I have the power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Table, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Hold your king."
They cried out,
Take him away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now, many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write, the King of the Jews, but he said, I am the King of the Jews."
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top down. So they said to one another,
"Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it,
to see who is able to be."
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots." This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop, and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first one and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloth along with spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now, in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
One of the Good Fridays I remember as a child is my home parish priest. He began with this sentence, "Today Jesus died." I don't remember the rest of his homily because his phrase was so stark and scary for any elementary school kid to hear. I realize today that the trial that led up to Jesus' death is most interesting. It's about authenticity, being true to oneself and being true to who you are. The words of Christ today are, "I am." Jesus does, he keeps himself true to this open communication, honest communication. He says, ask those who heard me. Nothing is in hiding. The question was, are you Jesus the Nazarene? And Christ responds, I am. Peter does something peculiar. He says, I am not, contrary to the I am. Peter says, I am not. Another person to say this was John the Baptist. But this was because he was being honest. The question to John the Baptist was, are you the Messiah? He responds, I am not. Are you Elijah? I am not. His honest answer was, I am the one preparing the way of the Lord. Tonight, Peter says, I am not, but for very different reasons. Peter is denying that he is a disciple of Christ. He is denying that he followed Christ. Peter is frightened and scared. And you know what? It's okay to be scared. It's okay to be frightened. It's okay to be terrified. Because we are human. You know what the difference between Judas and Peter was? One was betrayed. Peter is not a betrayer. He's simply human. When Judas betrayed Christ, that was the end of the road. But Peter still has a second chance. Peter, our rock and leader of this church, is displayed like a scared little boy. And that's okay. As St. Augustine says, the mistakes of the disciples gives us confidence. If the disciples were displayed as perfect, like many of our earthly heroes that are portrayed, And the question is, how can we relate to them? Peter was afraid because he didn't know strength yet. He was still being groomed. He had to learn inner strength. He had to learn courage. Christ could say, "I am," in front of accusations and blame because he was the embodiment of holy courage, of holy strength. And so, my brothers and sisters, if you are afraid, if you feel terrified, then ask God. Ask God for strength. Ask God for courage. God wants us to ask. By asking, we believe. And by believing, we are given that strength. We are like Peter in so many ways. We still do have a second chance. We are still learning to have that inner strength, to have that courage. And God will grant it to us. All we have to do is ask.
Hermanos, en esta tarde que recordamos de manera especial cómo nuestro Señor padeció tanto por nosotros, cómo murió por nuestros pecados, podemos reflexionar de tantos ángulos este misterio. Quisiera tomar solo uno de ellos. Quisiera tomar a San Agustín, quien se fija en la cruz como nuestra maestra. Se fija en la cruz como maestra y también se fija en la cruz como barca, como maestra y como barca. La cruz de nuestro Señor Jesús, maestra en que nos enseña realmente de qué se trata nuestra vida, en qué consiste nuestra vida. ¿Y qué nos enseña la cruz? Nos enseña que la vida es para entregarla. Y es lo que hizo Jesús. Entregó su vida por nosotros. La cruz entonces es maestra. Y nosotros hoy, después de nuestras oraciones de petición, que hoy son muy solemnes, vamos a tener oportunidad de adorar a esa maestra, a esa cruz de Cristo por la cual llegó la salvación al mundo. Y dámosle a nuestro Señor Jesús que por medio de la cruz, por medio de esa maestra, nos enseñe cómo servir, nos enseñe cómo amar, nos enseñe cómo permanecer fieles. La cruz, nuestra maestra. Y la segunda imagen de San Agustín para ayudarnos a postrarnos, a estar frente a este misterio tan grande de cómo Cristo padeció por medio de una cruz. Nos dice que la cruz es una barca. La cruz, una barca. Nuestro Señor Jesús, que tanto sufrió, incluso antes de llegar a la cruz, ya lo habían azotado, ya lo habían coronado con esas espinas, y hoy la humanidad entera se encuentra sufriendo. Jesús sufrió con esa corona de espinas y nosotros, una corona virus, un virus en forma de corona que ni siquiera lo podemos ver, tan pequeño que es, una corona microscópica, pero muy prevalente, que se repite, se replica, se hace fácilmente como cualquier virus y este un poco más, se hace presente, ya está en todos los países, una corona microscópica que está haciendo a la humanidad entera sufrir por enfermedades, por muerte, con desempleo. Pero llega Cristo con su corona, llega a esa cruz. Y nos dice San Agustín que la cruz también es barca. ¿Y qué hace una barca sino salvarnos de un gran océano? Nos hace poder navegar de un lugar a otro. Así es la cruz. La cruz es ese madero que nos hace navegar de este mundo al cielo, que nos hace navegar de nuestros problemas que quieren robar nuestra paz, que nos hace navegar hacia la paz de Cristo, que nos dice Cristo cuando Él resucita tanto, repetía eso nuestro Señor, la paz esté con ustedes. La cruz entonces es esa barca en la que todos cabemos. Es esa barca inmensa en la que cabe toda la humanidad. Y hoy día le pedimos al Señor cupo en él, que nos aparte un asiento en su cruz para que nos lleve nuestro Señor fuera de todo lo que está pasando, para que nos lleve a la salud, para que nos lleve otra vez a un tiempo de esta opresión por esta corona microscópica de este virus. Pidamos a nuestro Señor que nos dé cupo, nos dé espacio en su barca, en su cruz, que nos conceda mérito por los méritos de Él, de que cualquier sufrimiento que estemos nosotros pasando, Cristo lo transforme para la salvación nuestra, la salvación del mundo entero. Entonces, hermanos, los dejo con estas dos imágenes de San Agustín. Nuestra cruz, que es la cruz de nuestro Señor, que es maestra y que es barca. Que la maestra nos enseñe a vivir esta vida como Cristo quiere. Y que la barca nos conduzca a mejores tiempos y a estar más cerca de Dios en esta vida y mucho más en esa vida eterna que Él nos ha prometido. Vamos ahora a nuestras peticiones. Pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life with tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty. Let us kneel. Para que Dios para el nombre de los obispos, lo conserve a salvo y sin daño, para bien de la Iglesia, a fin de que pueda gobernar al pueblo de Dios.
Spirit,
by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Oremos también por los que no conocen a Dios, para que buscando con sinceridad lo que es recto, merezcan llegar hasta Él. Dios todopoderoso y eterno, que creaste a todos los hombres para que deseándote te busquen y encontrándote descansen en ti, concédenos que, en medio de las dificultades de este mundo, al ver los signos de tu amor y el testimonio de las buenas obras de los creyentes, todos los hombres se alegren al confesarte como único Dios verdadero y Padre de todos. Por Jesucristo nuestro Señor.
Amén.
Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will, for the true peace and freedom of all. The rights of peoples, look with favor and grace on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace and freedom of religion, may through your gift be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For the afflicted in time of pandemic, let us pray also for all those who suffer the consequences of the current pandemic, that God the Father may grant health to the sick, strength to those who care for them, comfort to families, and salvation to all the victims who have died. Because of this pandemic, relieve the pain of the sick, give strength to those who care for them, welcome into your peace those who have died, and throughout this time of tribulation, grant that we may all find comfort in your merciful love, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Oremos, hermanos muy queridos, a Dios Padre Todopoderoso, para que libre al mundo de todos sus errores, aleje las enfermedades, alimente a los que tienen hambre, libere a los encarcelados y haga justicia a los oprimidos. Conceda seguridad a los que viajan, un buen retorno a los que se hallan lejos de su hogar, la salud a los enfermos, y la salvación a los moribundos. Dios todopoderoso y eterno, consuelo de los afligidos y fortaleza de los que sufren, escucha a los que que todos experimenten en sus necesidades la alegría de tu misericordia, por Jesucristo nuestro Señor.
Amén. Amén.
I'm going to close the altar, and then before that, actually, the cross. We're going to bring the cross from the sacristy in our time of veneration.
Thank you.
ofensas, como también nosotros perdonamos a los que nos ofenden. No nos dejes caer en tentación y líbranos de mal.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, power, and glory is now and forever.
Señor Jesucristo, la comunión de tu cuerpo, no sea un motivo de juicio y condenación, sino que por tu piedad nos aproveche para vivir y sanear el cuerpo y como remedio saludable. Oh, the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world, blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
but only say the word,
and my soul shall be healed.
preserve in us the warmth of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have life unceasingly devoted to you. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please bow down for the blessing. Señor, sobre este pueblo tuyo, que ha conmemorado la muerte de tu Hijo, en espera de su resurrección, la abundancia de tu bendición. Llegue a él tu perdón, reciba tu consuelo, sea creciente su fe santa y se consolide su eterna redención.